Imagine this. Vibrant wet meadow grasslands, alive with chirping birds and grass swaying in the wind. A picturesque image of nature conservation at its finest. The catch? This landscape doesn't stay the same without our help. But maybe not the way you'd think.
Im Nationalpark muss gemäht werden.
Mowing is necessary in the national park because we want to maintain the current state of the landscape. In our case, this means that we have floodplain meadows and want to prevent shrub encroachment, so a different landscape is created at some point.
Ein anderes Landschaftsbild sich zeigt.
If mowing is not carried out regularly, the composition of the plants growing there changes. Pioneer species begin to colonize the open areas, while other species disappear. The landscape as a whole changes. However, the timing of this maintenance poses a challenge. Late summer or early autumn, after the nesting and breeding season, is chosen to minimize disturbance. But this creates an unexpected problem.
The older the grass gets, the woodier it becomes. It lignifies and becomes increasingly poor in nutrients. Consequently, the older this grass is, the less suitable it is for animal feed.
Furthermore, the grass is not suitable for efficient biogas production. All in all, this results in a surplus of unused grass. A collaboration between the German Research Center, Leibniz Institute of Agricultural Engineering and Bioeconomy, ATB, and the National Park Association of the Lower Oder Valley in Brandenburg offers a solution for the excess grass produced during conservation efforts. Instead of letting it go to waste, they propose turning it into biochar, a renewable carbon source traditionally derived from wood and with many application areas. The bales from the national park area were delivered to ATB in Potsdam. To prevent the grass from getting tangled in the machines in the following steps, the long blades of grass are first put in a shredder. The cut grass is then fed into a screw press. Here, the grass is pressed and heated to 80 degrees Celsius, and finally screwed out as briquettes that will be turned into biochar in the next step. The briquettes are taken to the pyrolysis reactor. In a continuous process, they are then transported through a large screw conveyor into the pyrolysis chamber. Here, the briquettes are burned at a temperature ranging from 600 to 800 degrees Celsius without oxygen. At the end, the biochar is collected in large bags and can be stored for a long time. But the biochar is not the only useful product that comes out of the pyrolysis process.
You can imagine a pyrolysis plant or a plant that produces biochar as a heater. So a farm that has excess grass produces biochar itself, and then they have a pyrolysis plant that's pretty much their heater.
This method has practical uses for the surplus grass, and it can provide heat, but it doesn't stop there. Biochar is a soil amender. So the researchers mixed it with the soil in growing trails to check its influence.
The effects that it always has is that biochar is a material with very high surface area. So you can imagine it a bit like a sponge, and it can increase the water holding capacity, which means that when it rains, it retains the water for a longer time and thus makes the soil more drought resistant. It also increases the nutrient retention, so nutrients don't go further into the soil when it rains, and it changes the microbial situation in the soil. So different microbes settle on this biochar and they can grow there.
Despite the evident advantages, integrating grass-based biochar into German agriculture still faces regulatory challenges. The German demonstration site of the GoGrass project aims to show the dual benefits for farmers and national park. They hope to bring about a change in policy by supporting sustainable farming practices and nature conservation.